Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the... I'm just gonna hold this. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. Glad to see each and every one of you here this morning as we do our two services. Here at County Line Church, we got a prosperity, a drive-in service this morning. And trust went well, and here we are today. And actually, I kind of can have three services. We've got the Facebook Live going on. So if you're here or you were at the drive-in service this morning or you're watching somewhere now, we welcome you to County Line Church, we got a prosperity. I'd like to read a verse of scripture out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Actually, it's about two verses. With a preemptive question, are you making God happy? That's something that we should take into consideration from time to time. I know there's, I'll be honest, there's times I'm sure I have to make God happy. But should we strive to make God happy? Yes. And can God be happy with us? Well, I know God loves us. We know that. That's a given. We know that. But I think there are times that, yes, God may not be happy with us. I know those of you who are parents understand the idea that you love your children regardless. You love them unconditionally. But there are times when you might not be happy with them. Whether it be decisions they make or attitudes they carry or whatnot. We love our children, but sometimes we just might not be happy with them at any given moment. So how to make God happy? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, starting in verse 1. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we've instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. And I'm going to go ahead and read 3 to it. It is Jesus' will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. And I urge you to do your own homework and go on and read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Just read the rest of that. It gets kind of lengthy. And it tells us how to make God happy and the things we can do to make Him unhappy. But I trust that we're striving constantly to make God happy. And a relationship with Jesus Christ is the best way to do that. And if you haven't done that this morning, I would pray that today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
The things that make God happy remind me of a story I heard. And I think I may have told this one night while we were doing the those lessons for that book. Perfect Human Life, yeah. I heard a story about a fellow. You know, we always hear the stories about somebody going to the pearly gates and meeting St. Peter. You know, we know that's just kind of a stereotypical kind of joke, the way it starts off. But this kind of starts off the same way. This guy, he had died, and he went to the pearly gates, and he met St. Peter. And St. Peter was taking him to his mansion, you know, where it says you have a mansion waiting on, you know. So St. Peter was taking him to his mansion, and as they're traveling along, they're passing all these other mansions that may not have someone in them, but they may be mansions waiting for somebody else. And they pass one mansion, and Pastor Jason out in front of the mansion on the mailbox, and there were flags, big San Francisco 49er flags out in the yard and on the mailbox. And he asked St. Peter, he said, whose house is that? And he said, well, that house is in reserve, so that's going to be Joe Montana's when he gets here. When he, you know. So they go on down the road, and they see another one. And this one's got on the mailbox and flags, and it's got Pittsburgh Steelers stuff everywhere. It's draped everywhere. He said, whose is that? And he said, well, that one's on reserve too. He said, we're hoping things are going to turn out right, but that one's on reserve for Terry Bradshaw, you know, should the time come. They went on down, they going up this hill, and they saw this huge house. I mean, it's huge. And it was decorated, and it had been redecorated, actually, because the new decorations all said Las Vegas Raiders. And this stuff was everywhere. And the guy said, "So whose house is that?" And when he goes, and he said, "Oh no, that's God's house." Okay, that was a pretty ridiculous representation of what makes God happy. But we can all use a good laugh. But again, I trust that we search ourselves and find that we're doing what makes God happy. Amen. If we could, we'll go ahead and at this time take up the offering. We'll have an usher to come and take up the offering, and then we'll have the worship team come forward.
Thank you.
Started in worship, Roy would like to come up for just a minute and bring something to our attention.
I thought she was going to get you guys on the
bag. We just want
to... We just want to congratulate our pastor and his wife, Jason and Kayla, for 16 years of marriage. And if you got more presentation, I have to go bring. There's some flowers for them, okay?
Thank you.
Today, Lord, for the goodness, your goodness, O Lord. We thank you for your strength and your mercy, Lord. We thank you for this time, Lord, as we get to be in your house today, Lord. What a privilege it is to be in the house of the Lord. We thank you so much, Jesus. We ask for your blessings upon this day. We pray, Lord, upon this service. We pray for your anointing to flow and move. We pray in the praise and worship that your Spirit would come down and meet us today, Lord. We ask for you to touch hearts, Lord, today. Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. Have your way. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
My heart's beating, my soul.
Thank you. But
the power of God is moving outside of the four walls. I sense the Lord's presence in a lot of different places now. A lot of different areas that I'm going to, and I'm seeing the hand of the Lord has been at work, and the anointing has been there, and the Spirit of the Lord is touching hearts, and people are crying, and people are being filled by the presence of the Lord. And how many know we need more of the presence of the Lord in our lives?
Amen.
We need the power of God in our lives. We need the anointing in our lives. We need the Spirit of the Lord, and He wants to give that to us. But the other day, this past week, I had an opportunity to, I had an old fridge and I went to throw away. And when I got to the dump, the man said, "It's going to cost such and such to throw this away, but if you want, you can go right down here to Jimmy's Recycling, and they'll take the fridge and pay you for it." I said, "Well, ain't no need for me to pay to throw a fridge away. I'd rather take some money for the fridge." So I went down to Recycling, and we got down there, and we got to testifying, and before long, it was four or five men surrounding in a circle, and as we began to brag on God and begin to talk about the goodness of God and the power of God and what God has done lately. How many know the Spirit of the Lord fell right there in that scrap yard?
Amen.
The power of God fell right down there in that scrap yard. You can look around and see junk everywhere. But how many know the power of God wants to move in places? And before long, we were calling on the Lord, and we were praying and laying hands on people. And by the way, I got a chance, Wayne, to lay hands on your first cousin, pray for him. He had to go to the doctor last week to get his heart checked out. But I tell you, how many know the Lord can take an old refrigerator? The Lord can take an old refrigerator and use it for the glory of God. How many believe that today?
Amen.
He can take an old refrigerator and know that appointed time for that refrigerator, or where its resting place would be the very point that somebody's heart would be touched and changed, and the Spirit of the Lord moved. And we were all, those men were lifting our hands. Come to find out, the man that runs it, Jamie's Recycling Center, I thought it was one man sending me the verse for all these years. Really, it was him. Jamie's Recycling was sending out the verse to a guy by the name of J.W. that was sending to me. And so the origin of the verse was coming from the very man that we got a chance to pray with. Hallelujah. And I know Jamie, but I didn't know the verse originated from him. And all this past week, it was verses on prayer. The men should lift their hands in prayer. I tell you, it was so powerful. And then Thursday night after the prayer meeting here, I was on the way home, and I pulled up in the driveway, and as I parked, I looked down at my phone, and I received a text. And the text said, "Are you home?" It came from my wife. I said, "Yeah, I'm home." She said, "But I really wanted some of these tortilla chips." How many's ever got a text when you pulled in the driveway that significant other wanted something and you was already home? Anyways, and so, but she wanted some tortilla chips for this good old homemade salsa that she made. It is unbelievable. And how do I know when she wanted some, it made me want some too. So as I pulled out of the driveway to head to Bowles to go get some more tortilla chips, and as I got inside the store of Bowles right here on Thursday night, the Holy Spirit began to move and to minister. And there was a young man in there that I got a chance to pray with and minister to and witness to. And then as I was leaving on the outside, I heard the voice of the Lord say, "Go back." There was somebody on the bench. I went back and got a chance to tell them about Jesus Christ and got a chance to pray with them. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move again. Church, it is time for the church to get out and be the church. It's time for the church to get out and spread the good news. The power of God wants to go with us and for us. And how many are thankful for the power of God? How many are thankful for that today? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord God Almighty. If you got your Bibles, I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 14. I feel the Lord is leading. Matthew 14, starting in verse 13, where Jesus feeds the 5,000. And then right after that, there was a storm at sea. And Matthew 14, starting in verse number 13. Matthew 13, and we're going to read starting in verse 13 of Matthew 14. It says, when Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place apart. And when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the cities. And Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude, and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. And when it was evening, his disciples came to him, saying, this is a desert place, and the time is now past. Send the multitudes away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves victuals, which is food. But Jesus said unto them, they need not depart. Give ye them to eat. And they say unto him, we have here but 5 loaves, 2 fishes. He said, bring them hither to me. And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass and take the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes and look upon heaven. He blessed and brake and gave the loaves to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled, and they took up the fragments that remained, 12 baskets full, and they had eaten, were about 5,000 men beside women and children. It doesn't say it in this particular gospel, but in one of the other gospels, it talks about it was a lad that brought his few little fishes and his few little pieces of bread. And he came, and Jesus Christ used what the young man had, and he multiplied it, did he not? Amen. And the Bible says that it was 5,000 men that were fed. That's not counting women and children. And isn't it amazing that God Almighty, Jesus Christ Himself, used someone, a little lad, a little boy, that was not even counted among the 5,000, to multiply, to perform a miracle, to feed 5,000 men. How many know this little boy that was counted as a nobody? In those times, the women and the children weren't even counted a lot of times. And here, God used a little boy that was not even counted, that was counted as a nobody, to use what he had to multiply. What point do I want to make today? Look at your neighbor and say, if people think you're a nobody, God can use you, hallelujah. God can use you, hallelujah. But the thing is, you've got to bring what you got. Bring what you got in order for Jesus to multiply what you have. And the thing that I really love in one of the Gospels is Jesus prayed and he thanked before he multiplied it. How many know you got to be thankful for what you got, amen, in order to receive the greater blessings that God has for you? How many believe that today? How many of you realize right now in the last days we're living in, so many people are selfish, so many people are ungrateful? How many have seen the ungratefulness today that you're living in? Somebody gets a free sack lunch from schools and people complain about it all around the country. How many know if you get something free, I don't care if it's a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, you ought to thank God for it. How many agree with that name? If you believe that, somebody say something. But the problem is you can't please people. You got so much greed and so much. But you know what? When God shows up and brings in 4 bag lunches to my house for my children every day, how many know I say thank you, Jesus? Thank you, Jesus. Because that's about $20 worth in my books when I write it down. Had somebody showed up at my front door with a $20 bill, somebody ought to say amen, hallelujah. Amen. You see, when you're thankful for what God has given you, how many know God can begin to multiply? And when you're a good steward of what God has given you, how many know God can multiply things in your life that you would have never thought was possible? Some say, I'm not going to be a steward. Well, you are a steward. You either a good steward or you a bad steward. You either going to do what God wants you to do with what He's given you, or either you're going to throw it to the dogs, but let me
tell you something. You're either in God's book, you're a good steward, or a bad steward. But when God gives us something, we must thank the Lord for what He's done. And it's out of our thankfulness, out of our gratefulness, that God can send and open the windows of heaven and pour out a greater blessing upon you. If you believe that, somebody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
So if a piece of butter and jam sandwich shows up at your house, thank God Almighty. The next time you go make a turkey sandwich with mayonnaise on it, thank God Almighty. The next time you get to have something to eat for today, how many know we ought to thank God for it?
Amen.
And remember, it's in our thankfulness that God opens the windows of heaven. It's in our gratefulness. I believe it breaks the heart of God when He looks down and He sees ungrateful people. Because God, how many believe that God has been good to us? How many believe that God has been faithful to us? How many know that God has never failed us? How many believe that God has never forsaken us? How many believe that God is with us and not for us, for us and not against us? We serve God who is for us. And He used the little boy. You see, if the boy would have never shown up, if he'd have never showed up with his little bag lunch, if he would have stayed at home, if he would have been afraid to come, how many people are missing the greatest blessings on earth because they're afraid to come out of the house right now? How many know it's time for the saints of God to come out, to come out, to come out, to be what God has called us to be? We don't have to be afraid, church. We've got something. Look at your neighbor and say, you've got something inside of you that's different than what the world has. Hallelujah. And so God used a little boy that was not even counted amongst the number. How many are glad that I've sensed that God is going to use people in this day and time that nobody's counted on being used by God?
Amen.
There are some people, there are some children here, there are some youth here, there are some young adults of middle age, there are some elderly here that God is going to use if you just let them use you. If you'll be thankful for what God has given you, you'll be thankful for the gifts, even if you don't think they're important. How many know God thinks they're important? Hallelujah. God thinks they're important. But you got to show up and you got to bring what you got. If you got a bag lunch like the little boy, you gotta bring your gift and let God multiply. And so we know that Jesus Christ, He used it and He blessed it and He breathed upon it. And how many know when Jesus Christ wants to bless you, wants to fulfill His plans for you, how many would agree that nothing can stop that?
Amen.
Nothing can stop the blessings that God wants to pour upon you.
Amen.
Nothing can stop that. But it's in our gratefulness. And there's some that I think about, many of people that are very thankful, even for the simple things. And one person I think about, and I know I pick on them a lot, but when I think about someone that is so grateful and thankful, even for the simple things, I think about my brother Ryan. It don't take much to make that boy happy. It doesn't take much for him to be thankful for something. I mean, it don't matter. You know what I hear him say? I don't even know if he knows he says it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I don't even know if he knows he's saying it. But that grateful heart to be thankful. Because God didn't have to wake us up this morning.
Amen.
God didn't have to get us out of bed this morning. God didn't have to put a roof over our head, did He? God didn't have to put clothes on our back today. God didn't have to give us hot water. But how many are thankful for hot water today? Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many are thankful that the lights are on in the church? Hallelujah. How many are thankful for the new heat pumps that are in this church and we're cool right now? Everybody feeling good right now?
Amen.
How many are thankful for that? We've got so much to be thankful for. And a miracle happened. 5,000 men. But the good part about it, the Bible says, somebody tell me how many baskets were left over. There were so many baskets left over. How many are glad that God is not a God of barely enough? How many are glad that God is a God of more than enough? neighbor and say, he is more than enough. More than enough. And he makes a way. And that's the God that we serve. He doesn't provide just enough to barely get by. But God is more than enough. He'll give you what you need in due time. But after this miracle took place, and right after the miracle happened, and they were probably at this point wiping the crumbs from their faces, and they probably, I don't know how the fish tastes back then, but I guarantee you, it probably wasn't as good as the fish that we eat today that's fried up. Who knows? I could be wrong. But the fish was probably broiled, and my opinion, it's just not my favorite kind of fish, but how many know they were probably thankful for the fish that they ate? And as they were wiping their faces and just getting done eating, and they had finished filling their stomachs, and there was so much left over that they were all full. Everybody had more than enough. And then Jesus Christ is getting ready to teach a lesson to his disciples. How many know sometimes it seems like the very good moments of life when you're on a high, when you're feeling good and everything seems to be going good, and man, that God is good. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, something hits you. How many have ever seen that happen before? Boom, out of nowhere, man. Everything's going good. Bless God and praise God and worship God. And then a storm comes and you want to forget who God is. But remember, after good things happen sometimes, you're either coming from a storm or you're on the way into a storm. How many would agree with me on that one? If you live long enough, you either coming from a storm or you going to a storm. And those moments of coming out of a storm in life when everything's going grand, it's great. But you can guarantee when you live long enough, when the phone rings or you get that phone call about such and such passing away or something happens devastating, you get bad news from the doctor or whatever, how many know, boom, you're back in a storm. But sometimes in this life, the very storms that we go through are the very things that Jesus wants to teach us and show us. Because if we would have never went through a storm, we would have never known how powerful our God is. And sometimes it takes a storm to see the power of God. But I think about my wife and the storm that precious woman of mine, that precious wife of mine was in, and been in since a young girl. As many of you don't know, my wife had scoliosis as a young child. She had to wear a back brace 23 hours out of 24 hours. I didn't know her then. But I remember her saying how much it meant to her to take that brace off for 1 hour a day. And I thank God that she had a mother and a father that stuck with her and made sure she did what she was supposed to do, because now she can walk and she can do all the things that she enjoys doing. But some of the names that was called and people called her and the things and the mean things the kids said to her. And then a year or two ago, when my wife had a lot of problems, laying in a hospital bed with an abscess in her stomach, if it would have raptured, it could have took her out of this life. But it was in that moment of the storm that she seen just how powerful our God is.
Amen.
And if she had never been through that storm in her life, she would have never seen the power of God in such a real way. But as she was laying there, she said before, she laid there with so much pain, and I was standing beside her, or sitting beside her, and that abscess was in her, and some other things was going on inside of her. That abscess would have ruptured and could have took my wife out of here. But as she was in that pain, she began to lift her hands up and begin to praise God and pray. And I'll never forget it. As she lifted her hands up in prayer, you actually saw the angels blanketing you, correct, Caleb? She saw the feathers of the angels surrounding her. Psalms 91:4, correct? How many know Psalm 91:4? Go ahead and quote that for me, Caleb. Psalms 91 and verse 4. I'm going to quote that for you right now.
He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings he will cover you.
He will cover you with his feathers, and under the shadow of his refuge you will find shelter.
No, it says, and under his wings you will find refuge.
And under his wings you will find refuge. But it was in that moment, it was in that storm, it was in that time that she saw God in a new, fresh way. Hallelujah. And she saw the power of God in a new, fresh way. But the thing that the awesome part about God is, what did Jesus do with the bread before he multiplied? He did what? Somebody tell me. He broke it. He broke it. How many know it's in our brokenness? It's in our brokenness that there is a miracle in the making. How many believe that? If you do, somebody say amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It's in your brokenness. If you're here and you're broken today, if you're here and you're tired today, if you're here and you're sick and tired today, if you're here and you feel like everyone has given up on you, if you're here today and you feel like that there's no hope for you, let me tell you, in your brokenness, there is a miracle. You see, the miracle did not happen until Jesus did what? He broke that bread. He broke that bread. And so the thing that I want you to know today in your brokenness, hold on. Hold on, my friend, because the miracle is on the way. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say amen this morning.
Amen.
In our brokenness, Jesus wants to make a way. Jesus wants to perform a miracle. But here we are, verse 22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. First of all, when Jesus sent them away, Jesus already knew that a storm was getting ready to come, did he not? It isn't like Jesus was caught by surprise. Jesus is all known. And so he knew when he told them, he didn't ask them, he told them, get into the ship and go yonder. And Jesus in this time was wanting to teach the disciples a very important lesson. That even in the storms, Jesus is in control, is he not? Even in the storms, God is in control. Right now, there's people that think they're in control. Right now, you look around and you see what's going on, and you see whatever's going on with this COVID. How many know? God is still in control.
Amen.
He's still on the throne today. He's still got your life today in his hands. And so in verse 23 it says, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. Isn't that awesome to know, even when you think Jesus is nowhere close? How many know Jesus is just a breath away? Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many are glad of that? 24. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. They cried out for, look at your neighbor and say, the disciples were afraid. So here's 12 disciples, been walking with Jesus, just seeing a miracle, probably wiping crumbs off their chin, probably breath probably still smelled like fish and chips. Just seeing a miracle, just seeing the mighty hand of God, and now they're afraid. I mean, does it sound a lot like Christians today in the Church of America today? You've seen miracles, you've seen what God can do, but yet you're afraid to come out your house. You're afraid to come to the house of God. How many know? God is in control today.
Amen.
He's on the throne today. We don't have nothing to be afraid today. He's an almighty God. Somebody give God praise. If you believe God is in control. And if you think this COVID caught God by surprise, this didn't catch God by surprise. God sees be faithful and who ain't going to be faithful right now. He will see who really wants to be faithful and who doesn't right now. And so there's a test going on right now, and God is watching. And I'm going to tell you something, if we don't have no more faith in God than what we do as saints, it is a crying shame to see all across the world right now of how many people have lack of trust in God. God is in control, church. Newsflash. God is not surprised right now. Newsflash. God is still on the throne right now. Newsflash. God's got your life in his hands. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible says he knew you what? Before he what? Formed you. So therefore, he knew me that long ago. I'm going to know he knows me now. He knows my name. Hallelujah. Amen. And so here we have the disciples, like a lot of Christians today. They've seen the hand of God. They've seen what God can do. They see how mighty and how powerful God is. But yet, when the rubber meets the road, what? Man, you watch the news, and man, you hear about what they say about that COVID. Man. But God doesn't want us to be afraid. Just like the disciples, they're afraid. And so, it is a spirit, and it cried out for fear in verse 26. Sound like a lot of Christians, you know? Man, I'm afraid, verse 27. But straightway Jesus, and let me make a point real clear. I get a real big kick out of people that tell you they're afraid to go to church, but they'll go into a restaurant today. Can I get an amen about that?
Amen.
Can I get an amen about that?
Amen.
They tell you they're afraid to come to church, but you see them down in a restaurant somewhere down in the sermon house. Can I just be real with you? They tell you they're afraid to go to church, but you catch them in a grocery store somewhere. Have y'all figured out what I get as a pastor? I scratch my head and I ask God, why, Lord? Why, Lord? Is that okay for me to ask that question to God? I'm going to be real with you this morning. But we got to start putting a little bit more trust in God and realize if we say that we believe in God, then we're going to have to start trusting God for who he is. And let me tell you something. I believe you a whole lot more covered up in here than you are in a grocery store somewhere. Can I get an amen for that? You a whole lot more covered up in the house of God than you are down yonder somewhere.
Amen.
And so it's time to get back, church. And so the disciples, they were flesh just like we are. Verse 28, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. And when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. How many knows what you feel? A lot of times you are. Did you know that? It said he began to sink and he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and called him and said to him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Now, a lot of people talk junk about Peter right here. A lot of people say that he sunk, he didn't have no fear. But how many would agree? At least Peter did get out of the boat. How many other disciples did you see get out of the boat? Somebody tell me. Did anybody else get out of the boat? No. Just one. Jesus called. Peter was the only one that had enough faith to get out of the boat. He got out and he sunk. Some of you got faith to go and do it, but you're kind of sinking a little bit right now. How many know Jesus wants to grab me by the hand? Hallelujah.
Amen.
And he said, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Verse 32, and when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. And they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. You know what Jesus, what the lesson he wanted to teach the disciples that day? That he's the Lord of the wind. He's the Lord of the storms of our life. He's in control of our lives today. He's the God in authority today. And let me tell you something, church. God is in control of your life today. If you will just trust him, it's not about how much faith you got, but it's about who. Look at your neighbor and say, it's not about how much faith you got, but it's who you got faith in. It's who you got faith in. I hear some people talking about, man, I got this faith and that faith, and I got, man, it's not about your faith. I've heard some people people say if your faith would have been this and that, and you would have had this and that, you would have been this and that, or you would have been healed this and that. Let me tell you something. It's not about how big your faith is. That ain't got nothing to do with it. You know why? The Bible says if your faith is in what? As a grain of mustard seed. Has anybody ever seen a grain of mustard seed? Can y'all see my eyeball through this right here? I can see y'all, but y'all can't see me in this eyeball right here. Tiny faith. If you got some tiny faith today, and you believe in a big God, how many know God is going to do it? Hallelujah. Yeah. And whatever God decides to do, how many would agree that's A-OK? Whatever God decides to do with me, how many know that's A-OK? Whatever God decides for me to be, that's OK. Because my life's in the Almighty God's hands. I'm not my own. I mean, God's in control of me. And I just want you to know this morning, Kaylee, can I get you to play a song? I just want you to know whether you just seen a miracle or you living in the good times right now, or if you've left the good times and you're heading toward a storm or you're in a storm, I want you to know that God is still in control of that, okay? Amen. And I want us to place our trust in Jesus. Jesus is going to take care of us. We don't. What did that one shirt you have say, Cody? What did it say?
Christ over infectious diseases. Viruses and infectious diseases.
Yeah, Cody. I seen they had a shirt on the other day. Christ over viruses and what else?
Infectious diseases.
How many believe that the power of God is able to get rid of this mess out here and get you the power? In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
And God has kept us, hallelujah. And I thank God for His protecting power. And we plead the blood of Jesus over you. Let me tell you something. If you knew how much we prayed for you, if you knew how much we prayed for this church, if you only knew, and how many are thankful that God has kept this church?
Amen.
How many are thankful that God has watched over this church? And that I'm aware of, I'm aware of not one single soul from County Line Church of God of Prophecy has come down with COVID-19. I believe we ought to give God praise. How many know that God is powerful? The storm may be all around us, but how many know God is the King? Jesus is the King in the midst of the storm.
Amen.
Jesus wants to place you in the eye of the storm. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at the other side. But it shall not come nigh your dwelling. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Read Psalm 91. If you get afraid, you're watching too much of the news and you're hearing too many people. Come to know the church. Christians in the church are supposed to be the light to those out here that don't know any better. We're supposed to be different. And I advise you, read Psalm 91 as much as you can. Read Psalm 91 in the morning times. Wake up knowing that the God of Psalm 91 is the God of us. Hallelujah. He's the God. I'm going to ask every head to bow. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the power of the word today. We thank you for your mercy today. We thank you for your spirit today. We thank you that you're the God of miracles and you're the God of the storm. Father, we thank you that today, I know every one of us has been in a storm. Or are heading to a storm, or coming out of a storm. Every last one of us have been through many things. Some more than others, yes. But Father, you are the King of this storm. You're the King of glory. You're the King of righteousness. You're on the throne today. We don't have to fear anymore. We don't have to fear, Lord. I pray that the spirit of fear would be broken in this community in Jesus' name. The spirit of fear would be broken in this nation right now. In Jesus' name. The spirit of fear would be broken in this world today. Lord, I pray that that spirit of fear would be driven out of people. Driven out of saints. Driven out of those, Lord. Father, I pray you would send a revival amongst churches. I pray for those, Lord, Father, that have not been out in quite some time. Lord, I pray that you would somehow make a way, Jesus. I pray that the churches across this nation, across this world, would begin to be poured out by your power and your might, Lord. Lord, send your spirit, Lord, touch those, Jesus. Because where the anointing is, there is healing. There is strength, Lord. I pray for that one here today that might be hurt, it might be afflicted, might be going through a battle that only you know about. They may be in a storm that only you know about. Nobody even knows about it. It's all to themselves. But you know about it, Lord. I pray that you would give them rest today. Lord, give them the spirit of freedom today in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here this morning and you've been going through some things and you've had a little fear, you just need some prayer, I'm going to ask you to stick your hand up. Is there anybody else? See the hand. Anybody else? See the hands. Anybody else? See, yes. See the hands going up. Anybody else? Hallelujah. Yes, we see the hands. Jesus, you saw the hands that went up. You see those that humble themselves to raise their hands before you, Lord. Father, you know, Lord, what they're in need of right now, Jesus. Father, I pray that the spirit of fear would be cast away right now in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that you would help them and strengthen them and encourage them and be with them, Jesus. Father, I ask you to help them, Lord. Father, those that are not here right now that are living in fear, Lord, I pray right now in Jesus' mighty name that you would begin to work in them, Lord. I pray that the saints of God would begin to rise up and to be the church that you have called us to be. Not in fear, not in doubt, but we would rise up in Jesus' name to take our stand, to do what we've been commissioned to do. This life on earth is short. Lord, help us not to waste time in Jesus' name. Help us not to waste time. It's a trap of the enemy. I bind you, Satan, right now. Every negative thought, every negative fear, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, but of power, but of power, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Lord, release that power. Release that sound mind, Lord. Break the chains of a mind that's wandering, a mind that's living in fear. If it ever was a time, Jesus, that we need you, it's now. Lord, I ask you to help us, Jesus. We repent of our sins, Lord. We ask you to forgive us. We ask you to forgive, Lord. Forgive America, Jesus. As America's killed unborn babies by the millions and millions and millions. As the blood's crying out. Lord, I ask you, Lord, that you would intervene. Lord, I pray that Christians all across the world, Lord, would begin to see the truth coming up in this election, Lord. Father, I pray that the truth would be revealed, Jesus. Lord, I'm asking you, Father, oh, Lord, put the one in place, God, that you want in place, Jesus. That's all we ask. And Lord, I pray America could turn back to you, Lord. Lord, I pray you would begin to shut down abortion clinics.
Yes.
This is innocent children that you have created are being murdered, Lord. We ask for you to forgive us, Jesus. Forgive America. Lord, we ask you to forgive us, Lord, of pride and envy. Lord, we ask you to forgive us, Jesus, of idols that are in our lives, Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would cleanse us of this sin of idol worship. A person, place, thing, or idea that takes the place of God. That's what an idol is. Lord, I pray that right now nothing, no person, no place, no thing, no idea would take the place of you, O Lord. I pray that faith would rise and the enemies would be scattered. I pray that the heart of powerful prayer would rise up in this church in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that we would call on you, Lord, and you would answer, Lord. Many a time you say that we will call on you, you will answer, Jesus. Pour out your spirit, Lord. Let faithfulness arise, Lord. I pray that the faithfulness of saints will arise. And Lord, we ask this today, Lord. I pray for a blessing over families today. I pray for the children right now that are at home. Nobody, hardly taking care of some of these kids in America. Lord, I pray for the children all across this nation. Some of the children, their parents may be on drugs, or their parents may be not home, or they may be all alone and nobody taking care of them. Lord, I'm asking you to be with these children. Start a revival with children, Jesus. Lord, my heart has been heavy for the children in the United States of America. Lord, if you don't intervene, I don't know what's going to happen, Jesus. So, Lord, I ask you right now to send help. Heal this virus so children can go to school. Heal this virus, Lord Jesus, so people are not in fear any longer. Lord, I know just like the disciples were afraid, as we have many saints that are afraid right now. So, Lord, if the disciples were afraid, Lord, you know why some are afraid today, but I'm asking you to come and calm the storm of this nation right now in Jesus' name. Just like you did on that ship that day, just like you did for the disciples that day, Jesus, I'm asking you to calm the storm right here in this community, Lord. Lord, I pray for a blessing over these people. I pray, Lord, that you would strengthen them and encourage them and help them, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would assure them that you hear their call. You hear them when they pray, Lord. I pray that the past would be the past and would stop being defeated by the past. In Jesus' name, the past is the past in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, I pray that people would quit looking over their shoulder and they would look in front of them. That they would begin to look forward to what you have for them. Help us, oh Lord. If you're here this morning and you need prayer for anything, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. We can lay hands on you to pray for you. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Anybody at all? Father, we thank you so much for this time to be in your house, Lord. We thank you, Father, for what you are doing, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would help us with the storms of this life, Lord. I pray, Lord, as we go into storms of this life, Lord, if you're trying to teach us something, I pray, Lord, that you would help us to understand that you're just trying to show us something. You're just trying to show us how real you are. Sometimes it takes a test to have a testimony. Sometimes it takes a mess to have a message. Lord, we thank you that you've been faithful to us. Even through those days of tears and heartache and crying, Lord. Father, the Bible, your word says you know every tear that we cry. Hallelujah. Every tear you know. Every teardrop you know my number. I'm so glad when we get to heaven, the Bible says you'll wipe away every tear. I thank you for that, Jesus. That means that bottle of tears that you know it is going to be thrown away. Lord, bless these people. Give them joy and strength. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise.